All right. Thank you, everyone who has joined us so far. We're going to go ahead and get started here. I want to say good evening to everyone. Thank you all for joining our latest installment of our Bourbon with Bill webinar series. It's so wonderful to have everyone back again. My name is Amanda Chun, and I am thrilled to be your host today. This evening, we're going to be talking with third generation owner and CEO of MS Rao, Mr. Bill Rao, on the topic of the French Salon and the Royal Academy. Not only is he going to tell us the importance of these two institutions, but we will also be seeing 10 truly impressive paintings that were exhibited there. Before we jump in, I want to mention that if at any point throughout our conversation you have a question, please feel free to ask. Simply press that Q&A button that's at the bottom of your screen to type and send in your question. We're going to try to answer as many of those as we can before the end of the webinar. Now, without further ado, I would like to welcome the man of the hour, Mr. Bill Rao. Hi, Bill. How are you tonight?
I'm doing great. I'm not often the man of the hour, so it's nice to be here.
Great. You're always the man of the hour for us, Bill. All right. Before we jump in, I am sure a number of people are wondering just how the gallery is doing and New Orleans in general after Hurricane Ida. Can you give us your insights?
Certainly. Well, the gallery is doing fine. We had, you know, really minor damage, nothing that's more than a passing inconvenience. New Orleans is improving greatly. There was incredible amount of infrastructure to electrical systems and tree branches and obviously, you know, things like, you know, signs for highways that got damaged, and obviously a number of homes, but not a lot of businesses, and I would say New Orleans is 85% back. And, you know, I mean, if somebody wanted to schedule a visit, I would think if they waited another week or week and a half, and if they came certainly to the French Quarter and to a lot of the tourist places, they would not notice any difference at all.
Yeah, it does seem like a lot of things are opening back up. Great, thank you. So let's go ahead and get started on the topic at hand. We're going to look at some really stunning paintings this evening, but first, can you give us a quick 2-minute history lesson on the French Salon and the Royal Academy, just so we can get a sense of where we're going with the topic tonight and why these institutions were so important?
Well, certainly. During the 19th century, if an artist had a chance at fame, they had to exhibit at either the French Salon or the Royal Academy. These were the premier, and I said the 19th century, the 18th century also, these were the premier places for an artist to exhibit their work. All the works we're showing are 19th or very early 20th century, so somewhat concentrating on 19th century, but these were the places where the art critics went, these were the places where the people that loved art went, and the Salon was either biannually every 2 years or annually went back and forth. World Academy was every year. And if you got invited to work on, to put a painting in these places, you often worked for a year or two or three on it. And then after you worked on it, it still had to be accepted. So that's so important. They would put so much effort because this was their chance at fame, and they wanted to put their absolute single best art in front of the audience.
So can you tell us a little bit about what set the Paris Salon apart from other salons and the Royal Academy?
So, I mean, really, up until, I would say, through the 1950s, most people would say great taste came from, it immigrated from Paris. It started in Paris and left there. And certainly that was true in the 18th and 19th century. And the Paris Salon was different, you know, also it was older, it was more prestigious, but it was also in these giant rooms. Here's a picture, a painting of, you know, a couple of patrons looking at paintings in the Paris Salon. And now I want you to see how big these rooms were. Sometimes it was exhibited in different places, but sometimes in the Louvre, you know, with 40-foot ceilings in these giant rooms. So what is the meaning of that? The meaning of that is, if you were a small painting, you probably would not be seen. So if you were painting in the Paris Salon, what would happen? You'd want to paint a big painting, so it'd be noticed. You'd want to paint it bright and powerful, not dark and where it'd be hidden. And you'd want to put a great frame on it. And, you know, look at the frames on these paintings. None of them are the little skimpy frames. Why? Because if you put that, it would get lost on the walls. But most importantly, this was a way of an artist showing I am the best. And if you got invited to put a piece of art there, you had made it and you wanted to show the world that you had made it.
Great. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of those paintings that were exhibited there. We're going to start with the French Salon and this monumental portrait of Napoleon on the battlefield. So this measures over 7 feet high. And this is exactly, as you said, what you would expect from a Salon paintings in terms of both size and subject. So Bill, what can you tell us about the historic importance of this painting, as well as the significance of the Salon of 1812?
Well, the Salon of 1812 was significant because it was the last Salon of Napoleon being in power. For you that are very much history buffs, you'd say, wait a second, Battle of Waterloo wasn't 1815. If it was every biannually, it would have had a Salon in 1814. The Salon only lasted for a little bit of time, and a few weeks when it happened. And during the Salon of 1814, Napoleon was out of power. That's when he had lost after going to Russia and was sent to the Isle of Elba. He eventually escaped from Elba, had the 100 days where it ended in the Battle of Waterloo. But so this was the last Salon with Napoleon in power. And this painting is done, some would say, at the absolute pinnacle of Napoleon's power, and some would say at the beginning of his downfall. And both are right. The Battle of Borodino was the Battle of Moscow. Napoleon actually won the Battle of Borodino, but then made the fatal mistake of marching into Moscow, where one of the coldest winters in history had come around. Many, many years ago, I was in Moscow, and there's this fantastic sign, and I don't remember the dates, and I don't remember the exact date, and I don't remember the exact number, but it was roughly on November 17th, 1812, Napoleon Bonaparte marched his way going east with 362,000 soldiers. On February 14th, 1813, he marched his way going west with 33,000 soldiers. He had lost 90% of his force during the winter in Moscow. But this is this wonderful painting. Let's go to the next slide. Great detail of Napoleon right before the battle. Now it was fanciful. Let's go to the full painting picture if we can. You can see the scale of it with Mallory next to it. There's no mountains like this and no snow peaked mountains in the background. Why did the artist do this? The artist wasn't there. Franck had painted Napoleon before, so he knew what he looked like, and he knew that's Napoleon's horse, and that's the gentleman I can't remember his name. It was a famous gentleman that took care of Napoleon's horse. He knew what his horse looked like. It was very famous, but he didn't know what the landscape looked like, so it was all fanciful. So he painted this. And it was exhibited at the Salon. And there's Napoleon overlooking, getting ready to the greatest strategy and strategic, some would say, general of all times. And I want you to see the frame on this. Look at that. That's an empire frame. That's a style that Napoleon loved and cherished and felt it, was benefiting of his empire. And so it's original empire frame gold. He just stands out. And you could see, picture that Salon painting in the very beginning of all the paintings in the Salon, how this would have stood out.
Great, thank you, Bill. So we actually have our first question of the night. People are not being shy. Keep them coming, guys. The question here is, who actually sponsored the Paris Salon?
Well, the Paris Salon was sponsored by the Academy. And the Academy was an appointed body, was considered the most important artist in France. But because these were artists and these were traditional artists, they actually had a chart of what were the most important art that you could have. Number one was historical paintings. Number two were portraits. Number three were genre paintings. Number four were landscape paintings. And last was still life. So if you think of something like this, this one is really historical. I mean, even though it was of the time and it was a portrait at the same time, and a little bit of genre, it's telling the story of Napoleon before the battle, and it's landscape with landscape in the background. So it was all the things the Academy believed in, but the Academy had to invite you in. And who was the Academy? The most important artist of the day, and often the most traditional artist of the day.
Great, thank you. And speaking of style, this portrait that we're seeing right here is very neoclassical in style. It was one of these major movements that were heralded by the Salon. The other was Romanticism. And this painting, this next painting by Daniel Bouveret, is a perfect example of the sense of drama and emotion that was championed by the Romantic movement. Bill, what exactly is going on in this scene? And how does this painting relate to the Salon?
Well, so a little bit on, and I would not expect most Americans to know the burial of Manuel Lescaut. It's not well known in America, although I'll start by saying it comes from the Prevost novel, and it was one of the what you would call famed or infamous novels of all time. It was banned not once but twice. Why it was banned? It told the story of a French noble and falling in love with a prostitute, and that was just scandalous. And so this novel was so famous. Let me think. I think it inspired three other novels, innumerable artworks, this being one of them. Ballets, operas, and even a Japanese jazz opera, and a pop song, and a Korean pop song. I mean, everything. It's something that inspired so much other artwork of all different types. But putting that aside, so this tells an interesting story, and it's interesting to me being from New Orleans. So this French nobleman, he falls in love with this prostitute. She gets sent away to the terrible area of New Orleans, the French area of New Orleans. He follows her there. He has a temper. He ends up getting into a duel with the governor's nephew and kills him. And then once he's killed the governor's nephew, he realizes he has to run away, and they run away to the deserts of New Orleans. Now, it's conceivable that the topography of New Orleans has changed greatly in the last 300 years from when this book was written originally, there's really no deserts outside of New Orleans, and there's certainly no mountains, you know, unless climate change has really changed a whole bunch recently. But it was obviously fanciful. The artist had never been to New Orleans and was, you know, picturing what he thought it would look like. So they're on their way out of New Orleans, and she, even though he's the one wounded, look at his right wrist in the duel. She's the one that dies, and he's so distraught that if you think of it's a very Romeo and Juliet story, he starts digging the grave to bury her, and then he's going to bury himself next to her because he can't bear to live without her. Well, he ends up doing that, but he ends up being rescued, and then the story continues. He gets sent back to France, where he has more troubles. It's a tragedy. It's a love tragedy, but one of the great love stories. But it was so. You know, there's nothing you can do to promote a book better than to say it's banned. Everybody wanted to read it. It was something that everybody spoke about. And a 19th century artist, 19th century crowd seeing this painting in the Salon would have instantly realized, you know, the story of it, because they knew the story. It was famous. Now, one interesting fact about this painting, this of all the paintings I'm showing you, this is the only one that was not exhibited at the Salon. It's old. There was one that was slightly larger that was exhibited at the Salon, which is now lost. Nobody knows where it is. It's presumed lost or destroyed. What had happened was, and the reason why artists worked at the Salon is somebody came up to the artist, one would presume, and said, "I love the painting. And this is exact of the one that was larger, but it's too big for my wall. Will you paint one 15% smaller?" Which they did. This is the only remaining example. It wasn't exhibited this long, but it's besides being roughly 15% smaller, the exact same as the one that was in the Salon, which is now missing and gone and presumed lost forever.
All right, thank you, Bill. We actually have another question about the Napoleon painting. I wonder if we can go back to that slide quickly before we move forward. Someone is asking, what else is happening in the background of this picture? I know you mentioned the mountains. Can you comment on the other figures?
The soldiers getting ready. And I used to know this. You could tell by their hats what regiments they were from. Napoleon had a whole bunch of different regiments, and That's a tent, and they're obviously getting ready for battle. But other than that, I really can't tell you. But Napoleon, the idea of him with his telescope is he's overlooking the battlefield and deciding where his soldiers should go and where they should camp to defeat the Russians.
Great. Thank you, Bill. Thank you for shedding that clarity. All right. So this next picture, one more question. What can you tell us about the artist who created the Menon painting? Do you have any information on Daniel Bouveret?
Not much. So a lot of these artists, I don't want to call them one and dones because they had to be semi-famous to get there. But if an artist showed a lot of promise, they would often get invited to exhibit the Salon. But here's the problem. Look at all those paintings when you go back to that original thing in the Salon. How many of those artists do we know a lot about today? Maybe 10%, maybe 15%. Most of them didn't make it. Most of them didn't make it as an artist. So, first of all, life expectancy was low then. Some of these are, some artists died at 30 years old and 35 years old, or, and then there were artists that, one of my great stories is Camille Pissarro, which is not featured here. The great French impressionist, his wife berated on him, give up art. You can't make a living in art. It's a terrible business. And of all the impressionists, his family is the only one still in the art business and still painting and doing art. The one that whose wife gave him the most grief about being an artist. But, so if you think of that, it was very hard to make a living as an artist. And so I don't know much about Daniel Bouveret. I mean, we know when he was born, when he died, and so forth. But as a lot of artists, they put their masterpiece here, and then you don't see much of them other times because they didn't make it.
Great, thank you, and thank you for your questions. We appreciate them. Keep them coming. Just press that Q&A button at the bottom of the screen. All right, so this next painting we're going to look at, I guess, is an exception. A number of people know the name Lazarelle, a very popular artist. This work by Lazarelle was shown at the Salon of 1884, and it would undoubtedly have made waves among the exhibition's attendees. Bill, what can you tell us about Lazarelle and about the subject of this work?
Well, let's go to the bigger picture first, if we can. Yeah, so this doesn't show its scale. It doesn't show its beauty, but it's great. So Lazarelle was known for doing these wonderful costume. Some people would call him a costume painter or a musketeer painter. If you look at the figure on the left in red, that would have been a normal figure in a Lazarelle painting. And I'm not exaggerating what I'm about to say. The average Lazarelle painting is maybe 1/16 the size of this canvas. We'll get to the scale in a minute, but I don't want to take it off of this picture. So this is something that's really great because this is something that an art history person would have instantly recognized. This is painting in Rembrandt's studio. So it's actually, he would have gotten permission in the Rembrandt studio to go painting. And a lot of these things that are in the background, if you look in the very background, you see a horse on a suit of armor, and on the left, a giant carved cabinet, and in the front, a chair and a violin. These were objects that fall into many of Rembrandt's paintings. In fact, if you look at the frame picture, those are two figures that fall into Rembrandt's most famous picture, The Night Watch. So you have these giant, really three different paintings here, the figure on the left, the three in the middle, and the three on the right. Interesting, there's one other person in there, and that's on the left, the second person left, and that's actually Rembrandt himself painted there. So you have these wonderful scenes of people that would have known art history would have recognized this, but it's just a wonderful painting. Let's go to the next slide if we can. You can see its scale, and it just pops off the wall. It's in a frame that if you had to reproduce a frame, it would cost you $200,000. It's this giant, heavily carved, beautiful frame, and it's something that would put on the wall at the Salon would have just popped. It's an extraordinary work of art, and it literally is 16 times bigger than an average Lazarelle painting.
This one's absolutely incredible in person. You're right. It has to be seen to believed. incredible amount of detail. So this next painting we're going to look at by Cornet was exhibited just 1 year after the Les Rel, but it shows this really fascinating shift in style. Bill, can you tell us what's happening on this bench here and a little bit about the realist movement in general?
Certainly. I think it's important to understand the realist movement. When we talked about what was allowed at the Salon, it's really important because you have the Salon wanted to appeal to the people that were buyers, and they wanted to appeal to the wealthy and to the, and typically this would have been the more conservative group in France. And for many years, people did not, they only wanted to see things that Napoleon or history paintings or mythological paintings. They don't want to see real people. They don't want to see what, how workers lived and so forth. And that was it was a realist movement, how real people actually lived out there. And starting right around this time, it became somewhat acceptable to show paintings like this at the Salon. So that was the realist movement, where it became acceptable to show workers and something that somebody would have put in their house. So this is a great painting. First of all, I want to let you know that my daughter Rebecca and I were fortunate enough to get into a collection. And four of the works that we're seeing today came from one collection, the collector that collected Salon works. And this was one of the four, and we were looking at them, and the more we looked at this, the more we loved it. I was asking my daughter, which one do you like best? And I think I like this one. And it just grew on us. So what is it? These are people that are workers. It's late of summer night. They've been working and they're exhausted, and they're waiting for some type of transportation to come. And you can see they're sleeping and they're exhausted. It tells, hard work. The only one that's not sleeping is the female in pink, and she's sort of in a daze looking at it. But what really makes this painting special is if you look in the upper left corner, you see the bars and you see the sculpture, that's the Louvre. So here it is. You have it's sort of the great juxtaposition of reality of the workers that are outside the Louvre and the Louvre on the inside. And it would have clearly showed, that differential. But it's so well painted, it's so amazing. And it's just, you look at it, it just grabs you. It's a painting that you could look at for hours and see something different at every time.
Mm-hmm. So we have two great insightful questions here. The first, how could painters afford to have these really elaborate frames made for their works? Weren't most Salon artists struggling?
They were. But if you didn't have a great frame, you didn't make it. And keep in mind that labor was less money. Today, the person who can carve a frame like this frame might make $125 an hour. And let's use today's money so we don't confuse people. In the 19th century, that there were so many people that knew how to carve and so forth, they may have made $1 an hour, $1.50 an hour. Gold was less expensive to gild the frame. So when I say a frame like the Les Rel would have cost $200,000 to reproduce, and this one might cost $80,000 or $90,000 to reproduce, that may have been, one 50th of that number, or 1/100th of that number. It would have been a lot less money. So, and that's how they could afford to do it. But they also knew that unless they made it, unless they put it in a great frame, it just wouldn't exist. It wouldn't pop.
And one other question here: do you know anything about the original prices?
No, we don't. Very rarely do we know. The Salon did not issue a price list. Not everything was for sale. Sometimes what often was, if you got a great commission, you would paint a great painting. And then after you painted it, and you would say, can I put it in the Salon? I need to advertise it. And if that may have been part of the original deal when you painted for somebody, or maybe you painted it and somebody bought it and you said, listen, can I deliver it after the Salon, or can deliver it and pick it up and bring it to the Salon and bring it back? So not everything was for sale, but the ones that were for sale, there was no published price list, so we really don't know.
Okay, a few more questions coming in here. What is the translation of the title for this one, Bill?
I don't know.
I think it's the poverty bench or something along those lines.
That makes sense, yes.
Yeah. it's fitting.
My French is rudimentary at best.
And then one last question here. Do you think that the antique sculpture that you're viewing through the window is referencing time and relates to this endless ongoing labor that these people are enduring?
I do not think so, because I think I always smile when we try to interpret what the artist actually meant, because often we don't know. If you look at the sculpture, it's classical art. And so here it is, you know, the classic, you know, if they had almost anything else in there besides something classical, you wouldn't, first of all, know it was a Louvre. You might not know if it was a house, but having a classical sculpture in there, you know, it's a Louvre. And it just, my gut, and I don't know this for a fact, is that it was just showing, you know, the classics, and, you know, and here, there's a wall between what's on that side and what's this side.
Okay, great. Thank you. Clearly a very compelling work, but let's go ahead and move on. This next work was also exhibited at the Salon of 1885. It's a view of Two Bathers by Cortot. It really proves that neoclassicism still reigned supreme, even at this late date. Bill, what can you tell us about this work?
Okay, so it's really important to understand that Amanda just called this neoclassic, which in style it is. It's very neoclassical. And in a second, don't go there yet, we're going to see Penny Bangra, which is considered one of the great, you know, neoclassical paintings of all time. But it's also modern. Why is it modern? Because a frontal nude like this, and something, this is 1885. That wouldn't have happened in 1875. I doubt it would have happened in 1880. This was something that was brand new. It does remind me of, there was a great Mark Twain quote. Let me see if I can get this right. At noon, I observed a bevy of young native women, he was in Hawaii, bathing in the sea. And I went and sat down on their clothes to keep them from being stolen. I don't know why that reminds me of this quote. We can go to the Angra painting next. So here's a painting of Angra that was in the Salon of 1819. It caused a stir, a nude, and not being shy, she's looking at you. Yet, but even the fact that she's nude, you really don't see anything. You see part of her breast, you don't see all of it. You see part of her buttocks, you certainly don't see all of it, but you know it's all there. And this was one of the most, I would argue, one of the most important works of art in the history of art. Very neoclassical. We can go to our painting now. Here's ours. Ours is far bigger than their Angra painting. In fact, I have a quote here that an English critic wrote: "Few Englishmen would dare to paint such a subject as the baggedness of Mr. Cortot. Two admirable naked figures with full carnations, plump contours, and fine proportions in the foreground of a sandy beach, which they are supposed to be reclining." So that's one of the critics that actually loved the painting, and you could see where something like this would create a stir, and you have one redhead, you have one brunette, and it's just a strikingly beautiful painting. Look at the scale of it, how big it was. You know, when we talk about something popping off the walls, that would have popped up the walls in the Salon, and it would have caught everybody's eye, and it's one of those things that I love, because I'm a fan of neoclassical. I'm a fan of nudes. I'm a fan of beautiful works of art. I'm a fan of salons, and it just, it brings you in. There's one other thing I want to mention to you that's very important about large paintings. A large painting can achieve something that a small painting can't. It can make you feel part of the scene. You know, you feel like you're there when Mallory's sitting there looking at that painting, you feel like you're there. And often small paintings can't achieve that just because of their scale.
Beautiful piece. We have another stunning nude to discuss this evening, this time by the academic painter Emile Meunier. Bill, can you give us some insight into this painter, as well as the prevalence of mythological subjects such as this at the Salon?
I certainly can. So I mentioned that the Salon was ruled by the most important artist of the day. And in the late 19th century, the most important artist in the world was without any doubt William Bouguereau. William Bouguereau was the king of neoclassical and paintings, and the person who was head of his workshop, because he painted these giant paintings, he needed help, was Emil Meunier. And Bouguereau mastered skin tones and mastered, you know, the female form and so forth. And obviously Meunier learned under him and went off on his own. And Meunier paintings are at his best. Well, they were Bouguereau's. I mean, you know, at his best, because he did paint a lot of Bouguereau's work. So going back, there was Bouguereau did so many paintings at the Salon that some critics nicknamed it the Salon de Bouguereau, because he was always the premier painter there. So let's move forward. Now we have Meunier, his most famed student, his most famed person in the workshop, doing his Salon painting. So he creates this giant painting, and it's called Love Disarmed. And it's something we, as a general rule, don't know the classics that well. We all read the Iliad and Odyssey and all, but you know, we didn't study Greek gods and all that different things. But in the 19th century, every educated person they understood this, and they would have understood exactly what was happening here. And you know, this is the maiden keeping Cupid from you know, creating love with somebody. You know, she's taking his bow and arrows and playing a little hide and seek with them, or keep away with them, as he reaches for him, because he wants to create love, and she's having the love that's disarmed. And this is a mythological painting. Obviously it didn't exist, but this falls under the most prestigious type of paintings according to Salon, which were historical paintings or mythological paintings. And you know, great scale, beautiful. Look at the fountain on the bottom with the water coming out, and you know, the dove. But it's just beautiful because you have Cupid and the maiden, and it's sensual and you know, sexy, with her being, you know, topless but not being erotic at all.
We have a few questions here. The first is about the frame for this one. Someone's mentioning that it doesn't seem quite as elaborate as the other ones. Is there a reason for that?
This is, of all the ones that I'm showing, this is, and I would have to check this. I would guess this is the only one that's not in its original frame, but I don't know that for a fact. Well, I don't know, you know, you could have, this painting was big enough and was bold enough that it could have escaped with that frame on there in the Salon. Why? Maybe the person, this could have been painted for somebody and then loaned it to the Salon, and maybe that's the frame they wanted. Keep in mind, people were trying to put these between windows or between a fireplace and a wall or whatever the case, and you know, there was only so much space, so they could handle a 3 or 4 inch wide frame, but they couldn't handle an 8 inch wide frame, because an 8 inch wide frame is 8 inches bigger than a 4 inch wide frame, because obviously the 4 inches on each side. I'd have to see the back of this, if this is the original. I know it has been exhibited. You can actually see a number on the bottom left of it. So it may be original, but it's hard to say without seeing it. But it's not the typical Salon frame. If I had to bet, I would say it's not original, but I'd have to check.
Great, thank you. And then a question about the Salon in general. What was the security infrastructure of the Salons? Do you know if there was any type of security guard like we would have now, or if there was any theft or vandalism at the Salons?
There's no great stories of vandalism. I would certainly assume that there were guards. I mean, there was just too much, but I don't know that for a fact. And you know, they may have had the docents that we have, but I don't know that for a fact. I wish I could go back in time to go to the Salon. I would absolutely get a great thrill out of that, but that's a great question. I don't know the answer to, but keep in mind, most of these paintings were so big, you know, you weren't taking them off the wall easily and carrying it out.
Great, thank you. So this next portrait of a gilder by Barrett, it's going to bring us firmly into the 1890s. Bill, what are we seeing in this work?
So I love this painting. So it's once again a realist painting. It's showing somebody working. Yet, let's go to a bigger picture of it if we can. He's not unhappy, but you can see he's poor. Look at his clothes, look at his apron, look at his shirt, look at his pants, the patch on his pants and the dirt on his pants. But this is something that every artist every person going there would have known what he was doing. He's the person that's getting ready to gild the console. Whoever bought these paintings had gilded furniture, and they would have been putting these gilded frames over a gilded console or over gilded furniture. And so they would have recognized what he was doing. So this is somebody they would have known. They would have instinctively known, what he was doing. He is getting ready to put what's known as the gesso on there, which is the form that handles the gold, that holds the gold. On the console that's going to be a gilded console. And so but showing a worker that people would understand what he was doing. Not unlike today, if somebody was showing a tailor, oh, I get that, or a worker that you would say, oh, everybody knows what he's doing right there. And yet it's a great painting and a great frame. I love this frame because it's a double-sided frame. You see the inside, it's not carved, but with the wonderful flowers that come up and the rectangles on the side and then carved on the outside. So it really draws your eye to the work. It's a beautiful work of art. I happen to grow up in the antique world. And so, it especially appeals to me because, when I was a child, I would get brought into many workshops, and this doesn't look much different than a lot of cabinet makers' workshops still do.
Great, thank you. So in this next picture, we see another laborer. This one was presented just 4 years after the previous painting. I really love this painting. It has this sense of humble honesty to it that just makes it really compelling. Bill, can you tell us about the importance of this scene?
This is a really, really, really great work. I love this painting. So, it's a very rare subject. One of the great French impressionists was Calbat, Gustave Calbat. Gustave Calbat paints a painting, there it is, in 1875 or so, of a similar subject. We can go back to ours, and asked to be put in the Salon, and they refuse. Why? It's realist. It's too early. They don't want to see people working. Second, a shirtless man. I mean, that's it's just too risque. We don't show stuff like that. It's much less, if you look at ours, the shirtless man with his underwear a little bit coming out in the background, in the back. And mid 1890s, this would become somewhat acceptable. Now, the Calbat painting is one of my favorite works of art in the entire world. It's now in the Musée d'Orsay. It was refused to get in the Salon. He worked on it forever, and he tried. But this one was the only example of that type of work that ever made it to the Salon. So, but it's just a powerful work. He's working hard, phenomenal frame. I can't say enough great about this painting because it's one of the, little bald spot. And the bald spot's important because if you notice, it brings the color of his head and his back and his arms all together. It brings it together. And then you have the browns that sort of surround them and, the lighter bit of the floor that's right there. So you have all these different colors, but it all brings you to where, to him working and him concentrating on scraping the floor to make it perfect. It's a painting that I can't say enough about because it's also after one of my favorite works of art. I don't want to say it's after, that's not fair. It's in the style of one of my favorite works of art of all time that I'll never get a chance to own because it's in the Musée d'Orsay.
Yeah, I agree. This one's just absolutely incredible. So that's going to round out our Salon paintings for the evening. We're going to move from Paris to London. We have two Royal Academy paintings we're going to present this evening. But before we look at those, Bill, can you give us a little insight into London's Royal Academy and how it differed from the Paris Salon?
Certainly. First of all, if you remember the first slide of the Paris Salon, how tall the ceilings were. The buildings where the Royal Academy was and still is are not that tall. The ceilings aren't that tall. The rooms are not quite as big. Thus, the paintings, as a general, did not have to be that big. They had large paintings. They didn't have to be that big. And the frames didn't have to be as wonderful. They would stand out. Getting to the Royal Academy was a similar feat. The Royal Academy was every year. The Salon varied between biannually for a dozen, for 50 years and then annually, then biannually again. But the Royal Academy started maybe 100 years after the Salon. The Royal Academy is still going today. The Salon is not. If you ever get a chance to, if you're walking in the center of London, if you ever see the Academy, it's usually in the summer, go. Winston Churchill, famous for many reasons, once said that his greatest moment was when he was asked to put some of his art in the Royal Academy. And, you know, I might argue that might not have been his greatest moment, but, you know, he certainly felt vindicated as an artist when he was invited to go there. So the first president of the Royal Academy was Sir Joshua Reynolds. Thomas Gainsborough was one of the members. Benjamin West was one of the founding members. And so, you know, it was founded on this great English art, often portraiture in the beginning in historical paintings, but by the 19th century, it evolved. This painting is late 19th century that showing the Royal Academy. I wish we owned it, but we don't. But it's a great painting to show what the Royal Academy looked like.
Okay, so this first work that we're going to see that was exhibited there is the most modern that we're looking at today. This was exhibited in 1912, and it really captures the eye. Bill, what makes this so modern, and what's going on in this scene?
So I think 1912 is a really important year, and not because that's the year that MSRAL was founded. Most art experts would say modern art came in at World War I, 1914, and by 1918, 1919 is when modern art took over. Modern art became famous 1919, 1920. World War I brought in, but there's never a stop and start point. There's always a gradual beginning. And 1912, you're seeing that gradual beginning. What's going on here? Let's get a bigger picture first. Before I tell you what's happening overall, what makes this very modern? Look at the bottom right quadrant. You know, these people are floating. You have a baby. You have a jester. You have a female. You have a castle in the sky in the background. All this is just floating out there. It's not real. It's not based on any fact. It's an imagination, and that makes it, you know, that makes it very modern. But what's really happening in this painting is what makes it so special. It's called Death's Arrest, and what it is death is coming possibly to get the musician. And why this is something that we all face it, and it was very prevalent in certainly in 1912. Enjoy yourself, live life to the fullest. We don't know when death is coming. So go enjoy your music, enjoy your seas, enjoy your, you know, beach scenes, enjoy your children, enjoy, have fun with the jester, enjoy your women, you know, enjoy yourself, because we don't know when death is coming to get us. And it's something that, that's a subject that's been around a long time. The blue is a very modern color. Blue was not a color that was used in the 18th and 19th century with any prevalency. It's something that today if you ask most Americans what their favorite color, the majority of people, the number one color that you'll hear is blue. That would not have been the case in the 18th and 19th century. But here it's this wonderful blue color, big. Look at you know, the fishes in the sea and all the scenes on the bottom. It's modern on the bottom, but a classical scene, something that everybody would have understood immediately, you know, enjoy yourself, enjoy life.
Beautiful work. Now, last but not least, we are going to wrap up with a significant Pre-Raphaelite work that tells one of the most well-known stories in British history. Bill, what can you tell us about Sir Walter Raleigh?
Well, first of all, I want to mention Wallace. Wallace was a Pre-Raphaelite artist, and he painted three masterpieces. The other two are in museums, and this is the third. So this is something, it's wonderful, because if anybody ever wondered Wallace masterpiece, this is it. There'll never be another one for sale. But it shows one of the most important people in English history, Sir Walter Raleigh. Who was Sir Walter Raleigh? He was Queen Victoria's favorite soldier. He is credited with finding Virginia and naming Virginia, the colony of Virginia, after the Virgin Queen Elizabeth. He is credited with bringing tobacco back to Europe, although some modern historians believe other people did. But he certainly was the most famous person for bringing tobacco back. He was a great Renaissance man. He was learned. Everything about it was great. I mean, he was somebody who was a genius in many different respects. So what's happening here? This is Sir Walter Raleigh in the Tower of London. Why is he in the Tower of London? Because he's been sentenced to death. And he's been sentenced to death. So first of all, look in the upper left corner. That's Queen Elizabeth. He was Queen Elizabeth's favorite. She passes away. King James I comes along. He's not one of King James' favorite. King James thinks he's too much of a loose cannon. He arrests him and puts him in the Tower of London. There's somewhat of an outcry, and he releases him and says, "Don't mess up again." Sir Walter Raleigh attacks a neutral ship, pretty much of an ally ship, and they come back and they say, "Okay, if you don't, we're going to cut off relations unless you put him back in jail." They put him back in jail and sentenced to death. So this is him waiting his death sentence. But a little bit about the Pre-Raphaelites. The Pre-Raphaelites were a group of artists that believed that art got bastardized once Raphael came on the market and started doing his art. And so they wanted to make things that were pre-Raphael, and they became known as the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. But they really wanted to have things that were perfect. And what I mean by perfect, everything had to be historically correct. Do we have a picture of so this is, and we can go back to the next picture in a second. This is how the Tower of London looks. He would have gone to the Tower of London to paint this. Because he wanted everything perfect. Let's go back to our painting if you can. Go back two slides if you don't mind. Thank you so much. What's going on here? Yeah, in the upper left corner, you have ivy leaves. That's, the leaves of remembrance. He remembers the queen. The flowers, what are they? I'm trying to, they're red poppies. Red poppies signify death. He knows he's being sentenced to death. The globe, he was one of the owners of one of the very first globes ever made in England. And, there's the globe. This is interesting. The child on the right, that's King James's son. So King James is sending his son to learn from Sir Walter Raleigh. Here's somebody he's sentenced to death, but he knew he was such a genius and such a Renaissance man that he wanted him to learn. And the child is playing with bubbles. Why bubbles? Bubbles represented the fragility of life. And so this, every single thing here had a purpose. Why it was done. The map on the wall is the map of Virginia, which and every single thing here would have been done for a purpose and it was symbolic, and it was done because Sir Walter Raleigh by himself was so important, but the Pre-Raphaelites desired perfection in their works. And and unlike the painting we saw before this, which was a lot of fanciful things going on, this had all things imagined exactly as they would have been. And by the way, the king's son, of course, is in purple because that was the color of royalty. So, and that's in its original frame. And it's, to me, it's a great way to end because of all the paintings, because it's a great story. It's a great person. And it's done by a highly important Pre-Raphaelite artist of one of the most important art movements in the history of the world.
Great, thank you. And a wonderful, beautiful painting to wrap up with. Now is the time for some questions. I know people have been sending them in as we go, but please feel free to send in some more to us. And remember, just go ahead and click that Q&A button at the bottom. We're going to get to as many of those as we can. The first we have here, was there ever outrage at a display of a challenging work at the Salon or the Royal Academy?
I'm not sure I understand the question. If you're asking if there was outrage about works that didn't get accepted, always, because you would the artists tended to be friends with artists, and if one artist didn't get accepted, it'd be outrage. There was always controversial pictures. That Angra painting I showed you, that created a stir. I mean, how could you have a female not be shy about being nude, and sitting there and just saying, here I am, and not be embarrassed. You know, there was always outrage but the Salon and the Royal Academy were very careful not to push it too far. And probably that Ingres painting created more outrage than anything else, but definitely there were outrage over paintings that didn't get in.
Great, thank you. Were the exhibitions open to the public? Was there a price to enter?
They were open to the public. I'm saying this from memory, so I'm not far off. The Salon cost a franc in the 19th century to get in, which was, 50 cents. And on Sundays it was free. So if you didn't have money, you could go on Sundays. A lot of museums still follow that thing. Hey, it's this much money to get through, if you're a resident of this state, if you're a resident here, you can get in for free on Mondays or Saturdays or whatever. The Royal Academy also charged a very small amount to get in. But it was not, they wanted huge crowds. I think the Salon in its heyday had 450,000 visitors. This is in a period where Paris had less than 1 million people living in it. So if you think about it, half the people in Paris, and obviously some people went more than once, so it's counting, but roughly, half the people in Paris had, would have gone to the Salon.
Great, thank you. And I'm saying this from memory, but I think the Royal Academy was and still is free on Sundays. So if you ever go, Sunday's the day to go.
Okay, I'm wrong on that. I apologize. I've been to England so many times. I think everything costs a lot there. So I'm just.
All right. So let's see. Here's another one. Could you purchase a work of art at the Salon or the Academy?
Yes and no. Not everything was for sale, but it didn't have price tags on it. But you couldn't go there and say, I want number 73. You could find out who number 73, who the artist was, and get in contact with that person very easy and arrange to buy it, in which they would have been typically overjoyed.
Great. Okay. And looks like two more, unless people keep them coming if you want. Seeing that these paintings were displayed floor to ceiling, was there a place on the wall that an artist could hope to be displayed? Like, would you want to be up top where people can view you? Where would you hope to be?
You would certainly hope to be at eye level. Yeah, that's always the most ideal point. But first of all, when we go back to the picture of the Salon, think about it. There's something called Salon hanging, and a lot of people of an older generation than myself would have hung Salon painting on the wall, where they would have put paintings left and right all the way up to their ceiling and fit them in. I read something that, figuring out what went where in the Salon was not a favoritism, but a puzzle, because you didn't want three portraits next to each other, and you didn't want paintings, you didn't want, like, if you had a nude woman looking this way and a nude man looking that way, you wouldn't want them looking at each other, And so it was this giant puzzle of they would have had it, and they would have been playing with it where it went on the wall. It was a very difficult puzzle to achieve. So I don't believe that necessarily, because Bouguereau was most famous, that he would have gotten his pick of where it went. It was just sort of, where can this go that this works?
Makes sense. All right. So how far did the Academy exhibitions ripple out? I mean, were they covered in the newspapers? What kind of classes could visit them?
Oh, I mean, these were huge. This was, these were major, major. I mean, think of 450,000 people going. Every newspaper that would have dealt with anybody with money would have reported on it. Art critics would have written about it. It's hard to overstate how important an art critic is, was. Today, an art critic can come and talk about some modern art, they may or may not get noticed. An art critic was often deciding the fact whether an artist achieved fame or not. And art critics obviously would come and they would write, and that's how they made their living, by writing. So it would have been written up all over. If you were in Paducah, Kansas, you would have read something about the Salon. Granted, it might have been a few weeks after the Salon was finished, about what was there and what created a stir and what was, what people thought. This was worldwide news.
Great. One more question here. Did political leaders have an influence on what was or was not shown?
Yes and no. The answer officially was no. This was completely decided by artist. Obviously, these artists knew where their bud was bred, you know, where the bread was buttered on, not the butter was breaded on. And they knew that they couldn't offend politicians. So if you had a, you know, you wouldn't have showed something that would have greatly offended your prime minister, or, you know, if this was done in the reign of Napoleon III or Napoleon I, you know, or the king, you know, in between them, you wouldn't have offended them. You wouldn't have showed something that was offensive to them, because it would not have been a good business move. But so it was somewhat understated that you wouldn't, but it was never stated that you couldn't.
Okay. Another question just came in. Have we ever considered hosting a similar event as the Salon?
I would love to. The problem is getting this many paintings in one place. I would absolutely to have an exhibition like the Salon. I, you know, they're my favorite works. I would love to have an exhibition of Salon, but it's hard. And when we do our exhibitions here, we'll often fly works from all over. One of the problems with Salon paintings is they're big and they're really expensive to fly and move. But if I could ever achieve that, I'd pat myself on the back, because I'd be so proud of having a Salon exhibition.
It would certainly be something to see, that's for certain. All right, so I'm afraid that is all that we have time for today. Bill, I want to thank you so much for your time and your insight. It's always such a pleasure to talk to you about these subjects. And thanks to everyone who joined us today. If you are interested in viewing any of our previous webinars from the Bourbon with Bill series, I want to mention that you can access those past webinars on our YouTube page. I promise there are some real gems in there. So if you want to learn more about the topics we've discussed in the past, from historic icons to impressionism, please go check it out. I also want to say that after this webinar ends, you're going to be receiving a survey through your email. If you could do us a favor and go ahead and fill that out, it helps us to plan future webinars. It'd be a great help. It'll only take a minute, I promise. So please go ahead and fill that out and send it back in. With that, we're going to wrap things up here. Thanks again, Bill. Always a pleasure. All right. Everyone have a good evening. Take care. Bye-bye.